Hi, Matt.
Hi, Bob.
How you doing?
Doing good. Doing good.
Are you in Slate's offices?
I am, yes.
How are you liking the Slate thing?
I'm loving it. Loving it.
You're doing good work.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
And a lot of it, too. You're the most... Do people often comment on how productive you are?
Not as often as I would like. I think that should be basically like the top of the agenda at every meeting.
Would you like me to actually comment on it?
Yeah.
You're really productive.
Oh, yeah. Thank you.
No problem.
I guess. I mean, I guess that's good.
I
sort of believe in quantity over quality because...
No, but you manage to largely have it both ways. Pretty high quality analysis. You know, there's occasionally I might take the copy editor's pen, to your prose, if such a thing still existed.
Yeah, yeah. No, I mean, it's a problem. It's a problem. The typos are not ideal. I don't know. Even had an embarrassing misspelling of Andrew Breitbart on Twitter earlier today.
Oh, did you?
Yes.
On Twitter? Now, those are two different things right there that I hope to talk to you about. One is Andrew Breitbart.
Our subjects are all coming.
There's a convergence.
But we shouldn't skip.
No.
Yeah.
And then, so what, well, I guess we should tackle, well, Breitbart is the news more than Twitter.
Right.
Any thoughts on the correct spelling of his name?
I can't remember now if the I goes before E or the other way around.
No, I think the... I think it's E before I.
E before I.
Yes.
Right. Yeah, that makes sense.
That's hence the pronunciation.
Right. Otherwise, it'd be Breitbart.
Right.
Right.
That's a good mnemonic device, is to always think it's Breitbart, not Breitbart. That would be a good thing to memorize.
And there you have it.
Yeah. So, share your thoughts, Matt.
Well, you know, I was on the Twitters this morning. Heard the news, and I said that I think the convention around not speaking ill of the dead is dumb, and that the outlook for the world moving forward is improved without Andrew Breitbart in it.
You said that on Twitter?
I did.
You can't say that.
No. People got very upset.
Unfortunately, you can always just take things back on Twitter, right?
You can,
just
but
just
I...
pull them back, and then it didn't happen.
I choose not to take it back. And I think that, of course, obviously, you know, the man has a family. It's very sad for them, for his friends. But, you know, he was also, I mean, he was, an influential guy. I mean, he made a real difference in the world for the causes he wanted to champion. He was good at his job. But, you know, I think that the causes he wanted to champion were largely bad ones.
But is it just the causes? I mean, is it just an ideological disagreement?
Well, I mean, it's not just an ideological disagreement because, I mean, I really do think, and I think a lot of his fans have been saying this in their obituaries. I mean, if you read Jonah Goldberg, who I have a lot of disagreements with, but Jonah was singing Breitbart's praises, not just as someone who... like, agrees with Jonah about things, but as someone who was a real innovator in the medium, who really accomplished things and moved the ball forward, which Jonah admires because he agrees with him, but I don't. Whereas, you know, Jonah Goldberg is someone who I think is wrong about a lot of stuff, but is not making any particularly noteworthy impact on the universe.
You would, in theory, should Jonah pass before you or me, say, you would speak highly of him on the grounds that he was less influential than he might have been.
Well, you know,
that would be the central theme of your eulogy.
I'm not sure I would have a ton to say. I mean, obviously in life there's lots of people you're bound to disagree with about political issues, and that's fine. There's only a few people who I think really have make an impact on things. Breitbart was really instrumental personally in substantially dismantling Acorn. I don't think there's a lot of people in the media who, you know, have those kind of, like, notches on their belt, you know, who,
right.
who really, like, and he, I mean, he took down Anthony Weiner, he,
I would say he got an assist from Anthony himself in that
he
case.
He did. He got that poor woman from the Department of Agriculture.
Now this leads me to where I kind of thought you were heading. I mean, it seems to me if there are grounds for condemning a person shortly after death, it would not be merely that they disagree with you about things and were influential in the cause of their own ideology, that you thought, you know, you thought Acorn was good, they thought it was bad, But it would have to do with the ethical nature of their activities. And I think with that woman, Shirley Sherrod, I think was her name, indeed, you could make a case that it was really unconscionable how grotesquely he misrepresented what she said, right?
Absolutely. But I mean, I think that was, lots of stuff he did was more accurate than that. But I think it was the spirit of the whole thing. I saw another admiring conservative obituary, I think was titled something like Death of a Warrior or something like that, which I think is sort of right. That, you know, if you look at like David Brooks, right, or even someone whose work I don't like as much, Charles Krauthammer, those are guys who are writing pieces that are designed to like persuade people. And that's not really.
You mean they appeal to the actual cerebral part of the person?
Yeah, I mean, they're arguments, you know, and in theory, at least, the idea is that someone is supposed to open up the column and change their mind about things.
Yeah.
What Breitbart was doing, sometimes he had the goods, sometimes the goods were made up. But what he was doing was identifying targets, you know, and trying to eliminate them. It's a very different process from, I think, what your typical, you know, like, media pundit is doing in the world.
Yeah. There's a lot of that around these days, though. Doesn't it seem to you like there's more of that? Just the opposing teams targeting people and trying to discredit them in any way?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a sort of a growing kind of trend. Although, I mean, I'm not sure that anyone other than Breitbart was all that good at it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, for better or for worse. I mean, I do think you do see a lot of sort of attempted.
Well, I mean, like, for example, the cap thing. You know, there's an ad in the New York Times today smearing both Cap and Media Matters.
Right.
That kind of targeting is what I'm referring to.
Yeah, no, I mean, you see that. And you've seen, of course, people on the left have sort of gone very hard against the Koch brothers and
right,
their things.
Right.
But, you know, I don't think, that you quite see the same level of impact. Obviously, I used to work at the Center for American Progress, but I was back there last week. You know, it's alive and well, building still standing. You know, people take criticisms. Obviously, the idea here is to create, you know, trouble for them. But, you know, I don't know. I mean, they don't, you know, Andrew Breitbart would do it with a secret tape and possibly with a doctored secret tape. And, you know, I think really sort of like went for the jugular in a way that worked much more than anything, you know, I've seen out of Emergency Committee for Israel or whoever else is behind this cap stuff.
Mm-hmm. So you do not think highly of the convention whereby we refrain from criticizing the dead for a few weeks.
Yeah, I mean, I'm just not like a huge fan of that as a general practice. I mean, you know, a lot of people, I mean, when someone dies, you know, they get in the news, right? I mean, everyone writes a little thing about them. It seems like if you have effusively praiseful things to say, you know, that's a great time to do it. But it's a good time for like a real assessment. You know, if you want to see something more substantial, David Frum did a Breitbart obituary that's quite critical and, you know, goes beyond 140 characters, and, you know, I think it's worth people's time. But, I mean, like, what better time for David Frum to write a criticism of the influence of a very different figure in more or less the same ideological camp than right now, when other people in that camp are celebrating him?
Well, and in a sense, if you take your ideological cause seriously, it is the time to jump in, because the person's legacy is still congealing. And with that legacy, you know, there are ideological stakes. I mean, if he's remembered as this great guy, that will kind of matter.
Right. I mean, exactly. And particularly, I mean, you know, what I think of Breitbart is sort of neither here nor there. But I mean, I think that the David Frum point of view, you know, he sees himself as still engaged in some kind of battle over the definition of conservative politics in America.
Mm-hmm.
And it really makes a difference whether on the week that Andrew Breitbart dies, does the entire conservative movement hail him as a martyr and a hero? Or do people say, you know, this guy was successful at getting a lot of attention and building a lot of media brands, but I think had a deleterious impact on where we're going as a movement or what kind of media figures we want to have, right? I mean, if you, you know, I mean, if everyone bows out when they have critical things to say, that doesn't have a huge benefit on the world.
Mm-hmm. So what's your take for how this is? Are many people jumping in a critical way? I haven't paid attention to what's being said about Breitbart today.
No, I mean, I don't think there's been that much criticism. You know, people are generally inclined to be respectful. I mean, I personally, you know, I stand by what I tweeted, but like, as a matter of personal taste and inclination, I mean, I don't like really want to go write 2,000 words on this subject now either. You know, so I understand why people do that. You know, I think what I've seen has mostly been efforts by people to think of something nice to say.
It's what people naturally do. I mean, I once had a discussion with an evolutionary psychologist about whether that's an instinct almost. I mean, when there's especially when you're in the presence of people who knew someone who just died, whether it really is part of human nature to emphasize how positive your own feelings toward that person had been. There's a theory whereby it could actually have been adaptive during evolution, but
right. And I mean, it does seem like, you know, people feel whenever anyone, particularly if somebody dies on the younger side, you know, it's a little bit frightening. Even if it has something to do with you, and the instinct is to do something like life affirming and feel goody in response. And, you know, I certainly understand that.
Did you say anything about Christopher Hitchens when he passed away?
I'm not sure that I did. I sort of had, I don't know, mixed feelings about Christopher Hitchens' work.
I would call mine mixed at best. The Cathapala did a very nice kind of graceful but critical piece. I mean, not harsh and mean.
Yeah.
But appropriately critical.
It was interesting. I mean, she had, it seemed, I mean, she, I guess, worked with them for many years at The Nation and had like a larger quantity of feelings about Christopher Hitchens than I did.
Yeah.
I just never, I was not as big a fan of his as, you know, his big fans were. But consequently, I also didn't have some of the feelings, just like strongly negative feelings that others kind of had. I don't know. You know, he was a Slate guy a mainstay of the publication. But that whole, you know, kind of work has never really been my cup of tea.
Mm-hmm. So what should we move to, assuming we're all Breitbarted out here? We were going to talk about Twitter and successful jerks.
Successful, yeah, rich jerks.
I'm so torn. Let's talk about these jerks.
Right.
So you did a blog post not too long ago at Slate in your Moneybox column thing, space, on a piece of, I guess, in Wired or something, about a series of studies suggesting that there's a correlation between being successful and being an asshole, you might say.
Indeed.
If you didn't think that it was better to say jerk, which I think we've agreed it's better to say, right?
Yeah, well, you know, it's a family website.
It is a family website.
Whatever.
It's in fact, I'm right here in my house.
There you go.
So for example, people who drive nicer, high status cars are more likely to cut people off in traffic. It turns out. People, I think it was that people who make more money are more likely to indicate in an experiment that they're willing to kind of exploit people. You know. I think it involved kind of misleading the people in the course of negotiating really unfavorable terms for these people or something. So stuff like that.
Yeah.
And first of all, were you surprised?
No, not particularly.
Okay, I guess we can move on then. No, there is though the question of causality, right?
Right. I mean, that's what to me what was interesting is, I mean, on the one hand, you could say, well, people who have a more shall we say, cutthroat attitude toward life.
Right.
The kind of people inclined to cut off other cars in traffic when they can get away with it, that sort of same instinct, you know, helps you make more money in the world. And with the negotiation experiment, I mean, you could particularly imagine a story like that, right? That, I mean, people who are more ruthless at negotiating will presumably make more money than suckers. Now, the authors seem to want to draw the reverse inference based on a couple other sort of experiments they did where they asked people to, like, imagine themselves as being rich or poor and then do things. And we're trying to make the case that the experience of being a high-status individual makes you indifferent to the interests of others.
Mm-hmm.
Which, I mean, you know, that could be true, but it's...
Well, of course, both could be true.
Yes.
The latter, to me, does make a kind of Darwinian sense. I mean, you know, when you're high status, you can get away with more stuff because people are willing to be your friend on less favorable terms.
Right.
And they're willing to overlook your foibles and and so on. So it makes sense that, you know, when your status is elevated, you would take advantage of that fact, right? It's just an economical way to behave, to get away with as much as you can. And there's been a fair amount of work on how, you know, serotonin level, which seems to be one of the key mediators of how your behavioral repertoire might change in response to changes in status, right? There's been a lot of studies about how that is correlated with various things, including kinds of ethical behavior. So it makes sense to me that becoming successful would make you more of a jerk in certain contexts, in certain senses, right?
Right. I mean, well, I mean, definitely, you know, I mean, it's easy to imagine, like, the star performer in the workplace being the least conscientious about, you know, making a new pot of coffee or, you know, putting the new, like, you know, thing of water in the cooler.
Which is, in fact, generally the case. Am I wrong?
Right. I mean, that I think seems to be the case.
Do you ever do that kind of thing around Slate's offices?
No, I'm a model.
And so you think you're a star performer. Is that what you're telling us?
No, that's what I'm saying. I feel like I'm the new guy, so I still need to, you know, I need to try to be a good citizen.
So you are doing those things?
Yeah, yeah.
You were just in cleaning the bathroom before you came on camera.
You know, I try to be a conscientious member of the team. But I mean, that is, in my mind, at least somewhat related to the fact that, you know, I haven't been here as long as the other writers and staff.
Yeah, so I think it's easier if you're high status to be a jerk and yet still have people say he's such a nice guy about you. I think that's the deal, and so people exploit that.
Maybe so.
I think so.
I mean, the cutting off the traffic, you know, I mean, I thought was interesting, though, because it suggests like a more of a subconscious mechanism. Right. I mean, it's not.
Well, that's what I'm suggesting, though. I'm suggesting it's not. It's the fact that it's rational is the reason that it might be built in by natural selection at an unconscious level.
Right.
I don't mean we consciously follow the logic every time we do this at all.
Right.
So that's the whole theory. But I do think the other thing is sadly true that, you know, jerks do better. I mean, I really think it's not much of an overstatement to say that one of the main problems with the world is it's run by jerks. I mean, they achieve positions of power.
Well, there's a nuance to it, right? I mean, because getting ahead is in part about coalition building.
Right.
In a smart, savvy way, which is in part about being nice and about being helpful. I mean, so I think, you know, I think you would want to say that the people who get ahead are not systematically pro-social. At certain key moments, you know, they will have, you think about like Barack Obama's career, right? And there's a famous element early on when, you know, he had some mentor in Chicago and he was going to replace her in the state Senate. And then she changed her mind and decided she wanted to run for re-election again. And he, instead of backing down, very aggressively challenged signatures and got her kicked off the ballot. and was able to win, right? And so, on the one hand, like, that's a key episode in his rise. If he doesn't win that first election, you know, his whole road to the presidency may not happen. On the other hand, you know, how do you go from being one of many state senators to being a Senate candidate to being a presidential candidate? And it's in part by cultivating allies and making other people, you know, think well of you. It's not, you can't just be a constant defector. Or no one's gonna.
You have to target, you know, potentially reciprocal relationships. You know, harness that potential non-zero sumness out there. So with her, I mean, the fact that he knocked her off made her much less relevant to right. his future. You know, but I do think that's true. And maybe it's not a horrible thing that successful people are very, very targeted in their altruism. And it certainly accounts for the fact that there are differing reports about people. I mean, it's always seemed to me that it's ridiculous to evaluate a person the way it's commonly done, where somebody say, oh, he's really a nice guy. And then somebody else will like disagree as if the explanation isn't obvious. He's nice to some people and not nice to others.
Right.
You have had different experiences with him. Yeah, but it does seem to me, and I also have a hobby horse about how the elite universities are exacerbating this problem of self-centered jerks running the world. I mean, I guess that's the problem, okay? It's fine that when people are going to get things done, they use reciprocity efficiently and don't waste any energy. And, you know, the question is in how they decide what they want to get done. You would like... Sure. people in positions of great power and authority to want to do something other than continue to elevate themselves, unless that goal happens to be aligned with the public good.
I feel like this has become, you know, sort of the hidden problem with move toward less overt discrimination in American society, is that people who occupy elite positions in America today, I think, have a much more of a sense of, like, real desert for themselves than was necessarily the case in the
because
past.
Of the myth of meritocracy or even the reality of it?
Right. I mean, that an idea of meritocracy is mm-hmm. much stronger, which, I mean, the governing elites always right. believe that they deserve to rule, but there's a difference between someone believing that this is what they deserve in virtue of their position in some social caste rather than as an right. assessment of their personal merits, right? I mean, I think that Franklin Roosevelt's idea about himself mm-hmm. had something to do with his family and his position in society and being the kind of person who was supposed to be in a leadership role rather than that he as an individual had done.
Right. So there was an awareness that some of his status was inherited. And you're saying that fosters a sense of noblesse oblige or helps sustain it.
Whatever negative things it fosters or positive ones, they're different from, I think, the mentality of people who see it as, well, there was like a fair race. Mm-hmm. I'm on top because I'm better than everyone.
Mm-hmm. I can see that as a problem. But I just also think, you know, these universities, if you look at what it takes to get into elite universities.
Yes.
Basically, it takes a resume that could not possibly be the result of authentic motivation. You know, I mean, you have to have an array of I think increasingly more than even probably when you applied. But you have to have an array of accomplishments that, or it certainly helps, that are just suspiciously diverse and you know, I mean, well, just given the people you know who are applying to colleges, I mean, how many of them really just kind of follow their interests and then the thing they present to colleges is this authentic representation of their authentic selves? And no, these are people who, in conjunction with their parents often, are constructing these identities from age 5. And I'm just saying the kind of person who does that, who is so bent on getting into an elite university that they will do that, it seems to me unlikely that once they use this gateway to elitehood to get into a position where they can actually do something for the world, it seems unlikely to me that doing something for the world is actually going to be what's foremost on their mind.
Yes, I mean, they're very heavily selecting for a certain kind of calculating ambition.
Exactly.
Right? I mean, and so, you know, on the one hand, you incentivize people to engage in that behavior, but it's actually really, really difficult on the merits. And so the only people who succeed, I think, are people who have a inherent sort of disposition toward that kind of grasping ambition and almost excessive, you know, calculatingness. And part of it is simply the fact that, you know, the American population has, like, tripled since World War II. And they certainly haven't tripled the number of undergraduates at Princeton or Harvard or any place else like that. In the meantime, you know, a larger share of a much larger population is going to college, and elite institutions have expanded very modestly and become, you know, much more like ruthless winnowers of applicants and do it in a slightly strained way.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they could just set the bar lower and then do a lottery. Right.
I think that might be better. I really think that might be better. Just set it a little lower. And I mean, there is a lot of de facto randomness.
Right.
But
and you have to say, look, the way this works is you have to have a certain GPA in high school and your SAT scores have to be over a certain bar. If you meet those criteria and you want to come, send in the applications, mm-hmm. and then we'll do a lottery and we'll say who gets in.
Yeah.
You know, so, I mean, it would still be, it would be like maybe mentally stressful for, you know, families who are applying, but there'd be nothing to do exactly or worry about or a system to try to
do. That would be less stressful, ultimately.
Just say, look, it's...
Because the stress would be just one day, the day of the lottery.
Right. And if you didn't get it, you would say either, well, look, the problem here is that I lost a random lottery, mm-hmm. so I move on with my life. Or else, like, the problem here is just that, you know, like, my grades weren't good.
You know, that would also, and this is why these elite institutions wouldn't do it, but it would level out there would be fewer gradations among institutions, right?
Right.
So you would think, yeah, you know, all the Ivy League schools are the same, and for that matter, we can throw in half a dozen others,
Right. I mean, the Brown students and the Stanford students would just be different arbitrary subsets of the same pool of kids with high SAT scores. Now, at least, they maintain that there's this, like, very fine distinction
right.
between them all.
Right. So I'm in favor of the Iglesias plan.
Awesome.
So I wanted to ask you quickly for some Twitter tips. I just started doing Twitter, like, a couple of months ago. I don't even do it, actually. It's just that I am starting to acquire a few followers.
Right.
I do it a little tiny bit. But because I now have this space at the Atlantic, which is remarkably like one you used to have at the Atlantic, I'm following in your footsteps.
It's suspicious.
Someday I may write for Slate, in fact.
That's the
deal. And so it says you can follow me at the top. So people follow me. And that's the reason I now have, you know, more than like three followers.
Yeah.
But I'm still not doing much with it. And I, on the one hand, I really have a deepened appreciation for how kind of amazing it is and how interestingly, it can structure collaboration. And, you know, it's fascinating to me the way basically just saying, okay, there is a strict limit on how long these things can be. How that really has accelerated the working of the social brain. You know, it's chopped up the division of labor among people more finely and spread the collaboration out. And it's totally amazing.
So I wish we could run some kind of randomized control trials and see, you know, is 140 characters really optimal, or would 130 or 150 be even better?
You can imagine that
right?
It might be.
I mean, because clearly they've hit on something in the neighborhood of the right answer.
Yeah.
It's a huge success, but like we don't really, really know.
But what would your metric be? What would you, how would you evaluate the?
Well, I mean, I don't know. You know, I mean, it's like if I'm God, I want to just like run separate universes, tweaking this variable and see what happens.
I mean, I think it would be how fast people get to correct conclusions in realms where there is such thing as correctness, you know, where they're speculating about.
Oh, interesting.
Whatever. Because it is, well, the fundamental thing about Twitter is the way it accelerates the working of collaborative thinking, I think.
Right.
So, but anyway, I'm uncomfortable with it, partly because...
Because you're old school.
I'm old school. I'm old, period. And I'm old school.
You're old school. You write slowly.
I do write slowly.
You're a thoughtful, you know.
Are we getting the upside of my deficiencies? Keep going. I'm liking this. Go ahead.
This is just, you know, this is what I'm saying. You know, you write the big books.
I write the big books.
Right. But, you know, Twitter is about speed.
So I shouldn't have low self-esteem about this.
No, hold your head high. But I will tell you, there's practical things about getting a lot of Twitter followers, which is that you can tweet links to stuff you write.
Right.
So it gets traffic.
But too much self-promotion makes people suspicious, I think.
Yeah, right. But far more important than self-promotion is that if you're traveling someplace you haven't been before,
mm-hmm.
get restaurant recommendations.
Restaurant recommendations.
It's overwhelmingly the best thing about it. You know,
you get the recommendations? You ask people for them?
Yeah, you just, like, you tweet. You say, like, hey.
Yeah, but isn't that kind of obnoxious to the 98% of your followers who have never been to the city you're in?
Yeah, no. I mean, that's why that can't be all you do. But, you know, if you build up the following, then you can use it opportunistically. It's exactly what you're saying. If you need collaboration mm-hmm. on a question with, like, a concrete... Like, I was in Paris, and I thought to myself, there's probably a good Cambodian restaurant here. But I didn't know what it was. So I asked Twitter, what's a good Cambodian restaurant in Paris?
Mm-hmm.
And a bunch of people replied, and over 50% of the replies named the same place. So I went there, and it was great. It's called Le Cambodge. I recommend it. It's near, I think, the...
Okay, thanks, Matt. thank you for that. Listen, but how did that help you pick up followers? That helped you use followers?
No, right. I'm saying but that's my pitch to you, like, why you should...
Why I should work on followers so that next time I'm in Paris, I want a Cambodian restaurant.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I think that's a good point. I think I should devote 3 to 5 hours every day amassing followers so that next time I'm in Paris, I won't have to use that damn Michelin guide.
Look, restaurant recommendations are important.
Yeah, no, you've totally sold me. But here's my thing. It isn't just that I'm old school. It's that I am dispositionally the opposite of the kind of person that thrives in the modern technological environment. Okay,
right. Isn't that what old school mean? You just wanted to use more characters.
Yeah, see, that's why Twitter doesn't work for me. You would have just said old school.
Yeah.
No, it's a little different than old school because I was a misfit even before all this stuff.
I see.
I mean, I was very self-conscious and, well, let me cut to the chase. The thing about Twitter is, like, you know, lately, for better or worse, and I know you'll wisely tell me this is not a good idea, I've been writing about the Middle East. We all know where that leads, right?
Absolutely.
Never to good things. But anyway, so I've been picking up a lot of followers that have foreign-sounding names, you know, and I think some of them are not in America. And
so, yes.
So if I speak in the standard Twitter voice, which kind of, interestingly to me, kind of assumes that you're totally on that person's wavelength in terms of sense of humor. I mean, you do a lot of this. You do very funny jokes on Twitter. But if people don't really know Matt Iglesias, they may mistake the joke for something that they actively dislike.
Yeah.
So I just feel odd when I'm thinking of all these people out there who are just going to be scratching their heads when they read this. It makes it hard for me to say it. And when you think about it, that means I can't say anything. If you have a diverse Twitter following,
I mean, if you use it, you know, you have a voice that's your Twitter persona, and you know, you wind up getting followers that are overwhelmingly composed of people who like it.
Yeah, but maybe I guess that's not what I want. I want to bridge cultural and international chasms, of course.
Yeah, I mean, there was also a period in my life when I spent a lot of time on Twitter just arguing with Eli Lake, which I think is something you might enjoy. I eventually had to, like, move past that because it wasn't helping me get any restaurant recommendations.
I had a Twitter exchange with Eli, but he's the one who threw in the towel, so far as I can tell. I got the last word in. He said I'd written this thing about intervention in Syria, and he said it was, to somebody else, he said it was something like weak and feckless.
Yeah.
And I just tweeted, Eli, you forgot to mention Munich.
Right.
It was the last I heard. I didn't hear, so I won, right? If he doesn't reply.
I'm just saying, you know, in general, like, he's up for that. John Noonan is also a good neocon tweeter. You know, if you want to argue with people.
But that's good, right? Arguing is good. It builds awareness of you. brand awareness.
Oh, yeah, sure, I can. I find Twitter debates get a little, you know, I'm not that old school, but I'm old school enough to think that, like, it's hard to hash out the whole, like, Syria thing in 140 characters.
Could be. You might have to do a series of tweets for Syria.
I have started, though, now, whenever, you know, there's an at TNR account where they send out links to their stuff, and whenever they have a piece calling on the, you know, urging the start of a new war, I've started just retweeting it with a little LOL in front.
And do they in turn retweet your retweet?
No, not necessarily. I'm sort of bowing out of that whole game.
The foreign policy game, I know, and I got to say I'm a little disappointed. I mean, I would like to give you a little talking to here before we...
Yeah. I intend to get back in the game at some point.
Yeah, but how can you? Your job description is money box.
Sure, but I can always do different jobs at some other point in my life.
I mean, and do you worry that the foreign policy...
It's not like I couldn't find an editor here to pitch a foreign policy story to.
I don't know. Have you tried? Because I think maybe what happens is the foreign policy establishment actually paid Slate. You were such a dangerous radical back in the day, Matt, that I think CFR is paying your salary. And Slate is getting like 50%
cut. It's a huge bribe.
They wanted to take you out, and they did.
Also, everything is economic. Like, I was just writing today about, the huge economic consequences that some kind of military confrontation with Iran would have for the United States and for the world. Mm-hmm. Which I think is a real issue, obviously ought to be part of the foreign policy calculus around this. But in a way, I think if it's like presented as an economic policy argument or just a point about the world economy, mm-hmm. it has more resonance with people.
You'd hope, but I mean, like the you take the Afghanistan war, has that really caught on with people? Like how much that has cost us? Is that a significant source of the fact that we're finally slowly getting out?
Well, I mean, I actually do think that the budgetary issues have played a role in that. But I mean, there's a difference between a budget fiscal cost and
an immediate oil price spike. And
right. I mean, a sort of, you know,
plunging into global recession.
Of the global economy.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that, like, in fact, if the war in Afghanistan had been having some obvious negative macroeconomic consequences, that would have changed the debate around it. But it really didn't. I mean, I always felt it was a somewhat wasteful expenditure of resources to do that Obama surge and so forth. But there wasn't, like, you couldn't really say, like, in concrete terms, like, oh, these factories are closing down because... you know, we're doing counterinsurgency. I mean, maybe you could have, but I never kind of saw that. And I remember at one point back in, when I was at CAP back in 2008, you know, there was a lot of interest from just sort of political operatives in like painting a story whereby the continuing war in Iraq was like a major contributing factor to the downward slide of the economy. And no one could come up with any like credible, you know, reason for that to be true. And I remember Paul Krugman addressed that in a, you know, memorable piece and said, well, you know, actually fighting a pointless war kind of stimulates the economy, blah, blah. But Iran is different. I mean, you know, bombing Iran would bring like a sudden stop to a huge amount of oil production.
I guess. I mean, I think we actually don't. I just actually posted a piece today in The Atlantic saying that, yeah, it could be that the immediate, there will be a conflagration that's horrible in a million ways, but I think even if there's not, the long-term cost, not just in dollars, will be very high. But I applaud your initiative.
Sure.
And you should do more of it. So before we go, we should talk about your forthcoming book.
Yes.
The rent is too gosh darn high.
Too damn high. In honor of Jimmy McMillan.
Ah. Explain that reference.
Yeah, you may remember Jimmy McMillan, the rent is too damn high guy. He was running for governor of New York State on a third party candidacy. He had very funny mutton chops. And basically his shtick was to show up in the debates and say, the rent is too damn high. Huh. And he was a huge YouTube sensation.
Huh.
And I don't really agree with him about everything on policy. But
you think the rent is too damn high?
But I mean, I appreciated the effort to like move housing costs closer to the center of political debate, because I think it's really important in a way that people don't recognize. I mean, people, at least liberals, are sort of aware that there's an issue that they call affordable housing, which is a problem for poor people.
Mm-hmm.
And the problem, roughly speaking, is that if you're poor, it's hard to afford anything. And one of the things that it's hard to afford is housing. Which is a problem, but I think it's, I mean, you know, that's just the problem of being poor. If you're poor, you don't have money. It's bad.
Right.
And I think we should give poor people more money. A different problem is really the one that middle class people talk about, which is like, San Francisco's great, but it's so expensive. Or my brother moved to Phoenix and he wouldn't believe how big his house is. You know, and it was just, this movie, Wanderlust, you know, just showed this in a great way where they had one guy who was living in the West Village in New York and his brother was living in Atlanta. And, you know, for comic effect, I think they exaggerated exactly how tiny Manhattan apartments are. But it's a real thing. I mean, people make decisions all the time about where to live based on housing affordability, which is fine. But what it turns out is that the places where people are moving are places where houses are cheap, but those are also places where wages are very low. And so this is contributing to an overall stagnation of the American economy.
So shouldn't someone point out to them that although they're getting cheaper housing, they're having to accept cheaper wages?
Well, yeah. And I mean, I think people know that. I mean, that's why, you know, it's not like there's nobody living in San Francisco or San Jose or Austin. But what you would expect is that the most economically dynamic cities would have fast-growing populations, right? That, like, when the automobile industry was having its heyday, and it was like getting a job in a car factory was a great thing to do, the population of Detroit skyrocketed up. But if you look at the population of the Bay Area since 1990, it's basically flat. So the proportion of Americans who live in the Silicon Valley area has declined during all this like high-tech heyday. And that's because what's happened, it's not that nobody has moved there, obviously lots of people have moved there, but they've bid up the prices and have just sort of pushed other people out. And so we're really not able to take advantage of like the full power of these invasions.
Of what? Of the...
Well, in the case of Silicon Valley, of this sort of dynamism of the high-tech sector that, you know, obviously...
but couldn't you argue that actually it is taking advantage of it because the people who can stay are the people... If you accept that income reflects talent and the contribution you're making to the economy, then you say, well, it's now full of these high-income people. They must be talented and contributing to the giant Silicon Valley brain.
No, right. I mean, which is great. But the point is that if you had, if you relax the regulations on dense building, not only could those people live there, but many more other people could live there. You would have much better economic opportunities for people at, you know, around the median, for, you know, plumbers and hairdressers and restaurateurs.
So you're against zoning laws that keep density of housing very low.
Exactly.
I see. Well, okay, there is... I must say it's kind of an ironic time to make that argument in the sense that
it is
physical proximity used to be much more of a prerequisite for efficient social interaction before the invention of some things that we're like using to talk to each other.
Right. But in some ways it's more important for the economy than it used to be, because, you know, in a world of very sort of disaggregated information technology, of global trade integration, more and more employment is in the field of sort of direct face-to-face provision of services.
Ah.
Right? I mean, if you think about what
like, you mean like mowing people's lawns or like...
like cutting people's hair,
right.
Cooking people's food, you know, building people's cabinets.
Right.
Right. I mean, there's this whole large segment of work that can't really be done remotely, you know, by its nature, right? And so place matters a great deal, right? If you want to maximize your income fixing cars, right, you want to go someplace where, like, rich people with fancy cars are. So you can say, you know, like, I'm this great mechanic. You should pay me a lot of money to fix the car.
And the services business is important because a lot of these people are the people who in an earlier day would have been able to get a job in the manufacturing.
Yeah, I mean, exactly. And that, you know, the fate of, you know, like average people of, you know, who are hardworking and like want to show up and try hard and do a good job, but are not like super geniuses who are going to invent the next amazing company really matters a lot. And that was what people, there's a lot of nostalgia these days for like the heyday of the industrial economy. Some of it I think is misplaced, but you know, what people like about it was the idea that, you know, there were good jobs to be had, that people of who were diligent, but of basically average ability, like could get and hold on to. Mm-hmm. And that's now moved into the service sector.
Okay. Well, I'm sold enough to want to actually fork over the $3.99 for your book.
That is all we ask.
This is going to be, it's an electronic thing available. They can pre-order now. They can do the impulse buy now.
You can go to the iBook store, to Amazon. It's from Simon & Schuster.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Is this a new initiative at SNS, the new, the 80-page book?
It's pretty, I think Penguin, like, led the way on this among the major publishers, but Simon & Schuster's the ones who liked my idea, so.
Cool.
You know, so I love them.
I love SNS.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So, good. Everyone should read it. Well, thank you for illuminating so many things and helping to bring me into the information age.
Absolutely. There's a brave new world of restaurant recommendations awaits you.
Okay, I'll let you know. Well, maybe I'll follow you on Twitter. Oh, wait, that's my final question. What's the etiquette on, like, if somebody you know follows you, like, should you follow them just because you know them?
You know, I mean, I think you can start out that way. But at some point, you know,
it gets the clutter problem.
You just sit to your feed to keep it at something you actually want to use.
Right.
And to, like, obey good etiquette.
Right. I'll keep that in mind. Okay, so if I follow you and you don't follow me, I will not be offended.
No.
Because I'll realize I don't fit into the career path that you're ruthlessly pursuing.
You're old school.
Yeah. You have no further use for me.
No.
I don't blame you, man. Okay, well, thank you.
Thank you.
And let's do this again sometime.
Absolutely.
Okay, see ya.